All three people have qualified to be candidates for Singapore's upcoming presidential election. They have been issued certificates of eligibility from the Presidential Elections Committee. The three men are former GIC Chief Investment Officer Ng Kok Song, former NTUC Income CEO Tan Kin Lian, and former Senior Minister Tharman Shanmugaratnam. The committee says it's satisfied that each of them is a person of integrity, good character and reputation, and they meet the relevant public or private sector service requirements. The committee notes that Ng Kok Song was Group Chief Investment Officer of Singapore's Sovereign Wealth Fund for more than 3 years. It says Mr. Ng's performance in this position shows he has the experience and ability to effectively carry out the functions and duties of president. For Tan Kin Lian, the committee considered the size and complexity of NTUC Income Insurance, as well as Mr. Tan's performance as its CEO for more than 3 years. And looking at these, it says it's satisfied that Mr. Tan's experience and ability is comparable to leading a typical company with at least 500 million Singapore dollars in shareholders' equity. For Tharman Shanmugaratnam, the committee is satisfied that he has met the public sector service requirement, having been a minister for 3 or more years. Well, it's the first time since 2011 that more than one person is eligible to run in the presidential election. What's next? Tuesday is nomination day. If only one person submits his forms on that day, he will become president. But if there is a contest, Singapore will go to the polls on the 1st of September. The Elections Department also says it has rejected 3 applications. 10 community declarations were also rejected. Or 2 of the applicants did not apply for a certificate of eligibility. The other 8 were younger than 45 years old.
Presidential hopeful Ng Kok Song says he will give his very best in his bid for the presidency. GIC's former chief investment officer says he is seeking to be of service and build a united Singapore. In his statement, Mr. Ng says he would like to honour the generations before him who built a strong foundation for Singapore. He also hopes that everyone will do their best for current and future generations to ensure that Singapore continues to thrive.
A presidential hopeful Tan Kin Lian believes this year's election will be his time. He contested the election in 2011 but lost his deposit after getting less than 5% of the votes. This time, he believes more than half of the voters prefer to have a candidate who is perceived as independent of the government.
The conditions in 2023 are more favourable to me because many people are struggling with high cost of living, high cost of housing, and also uncertainty of jobs. They want to see somebody who can do, who can change these circumstances.
During a visit to a market in Kovan earlier today, Mr. Tan also said he wants to gain the support of young people. He says older generations are more familiar with him, but not those under the age of 30. He wants to give them a brighter future, including being able to afford to start a family.
I hope to be able to influence the policies, influence the government to change some of its policies so that life can be better for the people. My goals are to reduce the cost of living, to make housing affordable, and to make jobs secure and pay well.
Presidential hopeful Tharman Shanmugaratnam says he is looking forward to the contest after receiving his certificate of eligibility this morning.
I hope it's a dignified contest in keeping with the dignity of the office itself. Encourage all the candidates to make a positive case for themselves because they each bring something that's of value to Singapore.
Mr. Tharman was speaking on the sidelines of an event by Cerebral Palsy Alliance Singapore. He also says he's sorry that George Goh did not make the cut. Responding to a question on how this would affect his chances, Mr. Tharman says he's not making calculations based on who's contesting. Instead, he's running on his track record and purpose in life.
I only entered this race because I think things are changing, and the next phase of Singapore's development is going to require a different character to the presidency, and that's the reason why I entered this race. It's not for myself. It's not for myself.
And more, we're joined by Associate Professor Eugene Tan from the SMU School of Law. Professor Tan, welcome. Thanks for joining
us
this evening. Oh, it's shaping up to be a three-cornered fight. What do you think the state of play will be like from now until polling day?
Well, we can expect, the three candidates, to use the weekend, to further the electioneering in preparation for a nomination day. I think Singaporeans are gratified that, they will have the opportunity to go to the polls on the 1st of September. And I would say that there are ample choices. The question really for each Singaporean would be, who best fits the bill based on their criteria. So I would say that, we can expect, a keen contest. And I think this is what, will define this year's presidential election.
Interesting. What do you think will be the key differences this time round compared to the 2011 round?
Well, Jill, I think when you look at the geopolitics, which impinges upon the role of the president in terms of his representing Singapore abroad. And so the question of, do we have enough strategic space? How do we maintain friendly ties, with different countries? I think that's going to play, a big part. If you look at the custodial powers of the president, given the concern with cost of living, I think that there is that temptation, to use the reserves, to deal with issues such as cost of living as well as housing affordability. So I would say that, we would need a president, who would be able to make that discernment and judgment as to whether, if a government decides to draw down a past reserves for these sort of expenditures, whether those sort of expenditures should be permitted. And we're also looking at the first presidential election, in 12 years. So we are looking at a fairly sizable number, in my estimate, probably close to 500,000 voters out of 2.7 million voters who will be voting for the first time in a presidential election. And I think, that there is a lot going for them in terms of, wanting to find a candidate, who represents their ideals, but at the same time, who is able to get the job done, particularly in terms of the president's custodial powers, protecting the reserves, as well as the integrity of the public service.
Professor Tan, would you say that there was no question from the very start that these three men would be eligible to run for president?
I think I would pretty much agree with that particular assessment, right? So if you consider former Senior Minister Tharman Shanmugaratnam, he qualifies automatically by virtue of his long years of service as a cabinet minister. If we go on to look at Mr. Ng Kok Song, although he wasn't the top executive in Singapore Sovereign Wealth Fund, GIC, but I think when you look at the size of GIC in terms of the investments that it manages, right, easily a couple of hundred billions of dollars, and the role that the chief investment officer plays in that particular entity, I think Mr. Ng Kok Song had persuaded the Presidential Elections Committee that he does have the experience and ability that's comparable, to the top executive, in GIC. And so similarly for Mr. Tan Kin Lian, given that he was the CEO of NTUC Income Insurance, and during his term, the assets grew significantly. I understand that, in excess of a bit, in terms of the membership share, in excess of a billion, assets in excess of 17 billion. So again, they more than meet the minimum threshold requirement of $500 million shareholder equity.
Now, the three presidential hopefuls were actually four just only yesterday. And this is what the fourth had to say about today's developments. Well, he called it a very sad day. Presidential hopeful George Goh says he is very disappointed to be ruled ineligible to stand for the presidential election. He reveals that the PEC had rejected his reasoning that his experience in running his five companies is equivalent to that of a CEO running a single company. Speaking to the media, he insists that his own legal and financial advisors had advised him that he would have been eligible.
This group of people are the top people in Singapore. Are you saying they are all wrong? Cannot be. They are all from the system. Because I knew the system. That's why I asked this good friend to come forward. Please help me to take a look what I'm going to submit. That's why I'm fairly confident I should be qualified. By so many professionals beside me, I still stand. I should be qualified.
Mr. Goh, who is the founder of Harvey Norman Osier, says the decision is, quote, shocking news for Singapore, and it will deprive Singaporeans of a wider choice.
First, we have to respect what they have written there. To me, I cannot accept. Anyway, they have made a decision. I should be the one saying I cannot accept the decision given by them. I personally think it's not a fair decision.
Well, the Presidential Elections Committee has released a response to George Goh's unsuccessful application for a certificate of eligibility. The committee says it was required to consider whether an applicant has the experience and ability that comes from managing one very large private sector organisation. The experience and ability that comes from managing multiple smaller private sector organisations is not equivalent to this.
It says Mr. Goh's application acknowledges that the five companies are not owned by a common holding company. Despite that, Mr. Goh submitted that the five companies should be seen as a single private sector organisation. The committee says it has considered his submission but was not satisfied that the five companies constituted a single private sector organisation. Now, Eugene, bring you into the conversation following these developments. The first question, is this the first time that the PAC has had to reveal its reasons for rejection? And what's your reading into these reasons that they've given? It says in the statement that it was doing so because of public allegations made against the PEC.
Well, Jill, to my knowledge, yes. I think it's the first time where the PEC has chosen to respond, to public allegations. I am unaware of public allegations, such as Mr. Goh alleging that the committee was unfair in reviewing his application, that such allegations were made in previous presidential elections. And the presidential election laws, do provide for the PEC, to reveal, its correspondence with an unsuccessful applicant. And so what we have today, that has just come out is really that particular provision of the law, being put into effect. And I think here it is important, right, because we need to maintain the integrity of the electoral process. And so it is vital, that public allegations of unfairness, are dealt with, decisively by the PEC. So I would say that, the PEC was forced, to publish its correspondence with Mr. Goh. I think looking at the correspondence, the PEC did have a basis which is in compliant with the Singapore Constitution as to why it had rejected Mr. Goh's application for a certificate of eligibility.
Now, would you then say that revealing such information actually sets a precedence for future hopefuls in future elections?
Well, I think it does, right? It does because, it informs us that, if you want to apply for a certificate of eligibility, unless and you seek to aggregate a few companies together, they must all be part of a single holding company. You cannot add individual companies and say that, well, you know, the average shareholder equity when put together, you know, amounts to at least $500 million. And I think, you know, the PEC is right. When you look at the Constitution speaks of a company. And if you consider it further, you know, it makes sense, right? Because running a company of a scale and magnitude of $500 million is very different from running, let's say, you know, a company, five companies of $100 million, or what about 50 companies of $10 million? Or if we want to push it to the extreme, what about 500 million companies of $1 shareholder equity? So where does the PEC draw the line? And so I think, you know, it would then, you know, once you allow this aggregation, right, then the stringent requirement of $500 million shareholder equity becomes meaningless. But the PEC also went further, right? So they took the view that the five companies didn't add up, that they didn't form a single holding company. But they also looked to see whether any of the five individual companies that Mr. Goh relied on would meet the $500 million threshold or come close to it. And the committee came to the view that, the companies were significantly below, that $500 million threshold. Mm. So I think this should put to rest any concerns, you know, that the committee was unfair, in reviewing Mr. Goh's application.
Oh, could you explain whether chances would have been affected if they had applied on either the deliberative track or the automatic track?
I don't think it makes any difference, right? So in this case, you know, Mr. Goh knew that he doesn't qualify automatically, right? Because he didn't have a single company that has a shareholder equity of at least $500 million. So he sought to aggregate them. But I think it has come to a state where I think it is clear, you know, that is clearly untenable. So I think it is a correct decision, you know, based on my understanding of the Constitution. And I think the stringent standards are required. So he went on the deliberative track, and the PEC explained why even on the deliberative track, the PEC cannot exercise its discretion to give Mr. Goh a certificate of eligibility, right? Because he doesn't meet the requirements. And I think that's a short and simple answer. So I think it makes no difference, given that he doesn't qualify for the automatic track. He has to go on the deliberative track, but his track record doesn't justify a COE even under that particular track.
Thanks for joining us this evening, Associate Professor Eugene Tan from the SMU School of Law. Yeah.